think the message the Lord laid in my heart today, amen. I want to give you the title for. Usually I like to hold back the title a little bit, but I'm going to just tell you the title straight up forward. And it says, God will provide. Amen. God will provide. Amen. God will provide. Whatever you need, God will provide. Whatever you want, God does provide as well. Amen. But sometimes what you want may not be what you need. Amen. So sometimes we pray for what we want, and we're waiting for something that we want, and we say, why is God taking so long to answer my prayer? But it's because it's not what you need, it is what you want. God is a good God, because he will provide what you need. But the good thing is, he does it more abundantly. Amen. So what you may ask may be this much, but when God blesses you with what you need, he bring it up this high, beyond your expectation. That's a good God. That's a God who we serve. Amen? Amen. So God will provide. Amen. And as we read the scripture reading today, amen, one came out of Exodus and the other came out of Matthew. And I could tell you, saint, that if you listen to the word, the scripture, that though both of them talk about God providing, his provision for us, his provision in our life, his provision that he brings forth for us each and every day. And I want to read just a portion out of Matthew 20, verses 8 through 16. And I'm reading out of the King James Version. And it says, when even was come, the Lord of the vineyard said unto his steward, call the laborers and give them their hire, beginning from the last unto the first. When they came that were hired, about the 11th hour, they received every man a penny. All the same. No difference. All the same. Amen. But when the first came, they supposed that they should receive more. And they likewise received every man a penny. And when they had received it, they murmured against the good man of the house, saying, these last have wrought but 1 hour. And thou hast made them equal to us. They don't deserve to. What are you talking about being equal? Hey, I did more. I worked more. I put out more. I deserve more. I deserve the best. I need to get all of it. Where are you coming from thinking that you should get what I get? Who are you? I work harder. I'm here all the time. I am the best. I am me. I. Hallelujah. Okay, so then the word of God said, you got to listen to what God is, what God is speaking to us. Amen. Okay. But he answered one of them, saying, friend, I do thee no wrong. Didst not thou agree with me for a penny? Take thine is. And go thy way. I will give unto the last even unto thee. It is not lawful for me to do what I want with my own. If thine eye evil, because I am good, the last shall be the first, and the first shall be the last. For many are called, but few are chosen. Amen. Give God a hand praise. Amen. Many are called, but few are chosen. Let me put it to you this way. Few are ready. Amen. We are not chosen because we are not ready. But how do you make yourself
ready.
Can I make myself ready? No. I got to depend on God's grace to make me ready. And it's called the work of sanctification in my life and in your life. Amen? As much as we try, it's never us, always God, because God will provide. And it's interesting to see that how we feel in this relationship, even though the fellowship that we have to one another. And we often think that one deserves less. Or we often think that this one or that one is not the same and should not be treated equally. We all feel that someone out there who don't look right, don't dress right, don't speak right, don't deserve what we get. Even a person that all their life, they never saw God. They never came to church. They hang out in the club every Sunday instead of coming to church on Sunday. Matter of fact, they hang out in the club every weekend instead of coming to church on Sunday. They did all the things that we know is wrong. They never did one thing right. But some of us, we came to church every day. All the time we came to church. Every Sunday I'm in church. Then when we go before the throne of grace, we're wondering what's going on here. When all of a sudden, the person is ready to go on the last hour. And they said, pray for me that I may be saved. But should we say to this person, you live all your life without worshiping God. You never once come to church and now you want to be saved. Now you feel like you want to go into the kingdom of God. You don't deserve to be saved. You don't deserve to go into the kingdom of God because you ain't doing right all your life. Is that the way God is? God ain't like that. God don't care if it's the last minute that you have on this earth and you ask Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior and you ask him to forgive you for your sin, you are welcome into his kingdom. And Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. Even if you just live for that last minute on earth, Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. We go back to the prodigal son. Let's go here for a minute. Not the prodigal son himself, but the brother of the prodigal son. You see, a lot of time we focus on the prodigal son. How he left and came back and he didn't have anything and he remembered his father, the rich man, and he came running back into his father's grace and the father receiving him open arms. See, that's the way the Lord is. But then remember, he has a brother. The brother of the prodigal son who said, he don't deserve all this. Why are we killing the best calf and sacrificing all the best? I've been here all the time. I've been helping you. I've been laboring. I've been doing everything. He don't deserve what you're giving him. He's the one that took all the money. He squandered it. He wasted it. He don't deserve it. He's not worthy. I am, but he's not. I stood by your side. But he didn't. He left. So why are we doing this? Why are you sacrificing the best guy? Why are you giving him all the best? Why? Saint, as saint of God, of people of God, that is not what Jesus would do. Amen? And God is letting us know, amen, through these scriptures, through these verses, especially in Matthew, that he has no respect of person. We are all the same before his eyes. We all receive the same grace. It is his grace. It's not what I did or what I can do or what I have done. It is all God's grace. Amen. And it's God that sees favor in us. But I cannot judge my walk. I can't. And because I cannot judge my walk in the Lord, I can't judge your walk in the Lord either. The only one judges our walk is God himself. All I could do is pray for you, and I pray that you pray for me. We pray for each other to ensure that the walk that we walk in a walk of faith and glory to God every time he blesses us. If I see a sister or brother in need, God called me to pray. If you don't mind me taking off this jacket a little bit. Amen. You know, the Holy Spirit start heating things up in you. Amen. Praise God. Amen. It's a good thing to have the mic. Walk over there and come back and praise God from back there. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. So thank you, Jesus. So what we have is God's grace in our life. Amen. I can't judge you. I should not. Not that I can't. I shouldn't. Because it is God's grace that's operating in both of us, you and I. Amen. And what God is trying to show us here in Matthew is that it's not about who did the most, but it's about God. Is God in our life. Amen. What God calls us to do is to pray for each other. That's important because we are the church. And there are souls out there who are yearning and crying out for deliverance. They are in pain. They need God. They want that penny that we already got. They want salvation in their life. They have no answer, but we are the answer. The church is. But we have to learn first within our own house not to judge. Not to say that I'm better than you and you are better than me or anyone is better than anybody. What we have to learn to do is to pray. We see someone in fault, we need to pray for them. We pray for ourselves. We pray for them. We pray all day long because we, the church, is who has to overcome the ways of the world. We have to come against that. But we pray for one another. We have to pray for each and every one of us here to receive the faith, the strong faith, to walk the walk of faith. Amen. Let me share with you a little story. Amen. And I like to share these stories because I'm hoping that somehow we make a connection. And as I read the story, I want us to think about the message in the story. It says, faith on an island. Faith on an island. A voyaging ship was wrecked during a storm at sea. And only two men on it were able to swim to a small deserted island. Two survivors, not knowing what else to do, agreed that they had no other recourse but to pray to God. However, to find out whose prayer was more powerful, they agreed to divide the territory between them and stay on opposite side of the island. The first thing they prayed was for food. The next morning, the first man saw
a fruit-bearing tree on his side of the land. And he was able to eat fruit. The other man's parcel of land remained barren. After a week, the first man was lonely. He decided to pray for a spouse, a wife, a partner. The next day, another ship wrecked, and the only survivor was a woman who swam to his side of the land. And the other side of the island, there was nothing. Soon the first man prayed for a house and clothes and more food. The next day, like magic, all these things given to him. All these things was given to him. However, the second man still had nothing. Finally, the first man prayed for a ship so that he and his wife could leave the island. In the morning, he found a ship docked on his side of the island. My side. Yeah, not your side. Line in between. Don't cross that line. That's your side, is my side. Amen. We that's the way we do things. Amen. Praise God. So the first man boarded the ship with his wife and decided to leave the second man on the island. He considered the other man unworthy to receive God's blessing, since none of his prayer had been answered. He considered the other man to be unworthy because, based upon his observation, what he saw with his eyes, from his perspective, he wasn't getting blessed in his life. For therefore, he's unworthy to be saved or to be in the grace of God. God is not listening to a person like that. Because if God were, why are they not being blessed? Why are they not being blessed like I am? Like we are. We are blessed, amen? We got everything we need, amen? But what about them? They ain't got nothing. No, God ain't listening to them. Amen? Because of what we see, what we saw, what we perceive with our eyes, with our mind. But the work of God is from our heart. Amen? Not from here or here, but from here. So, amen? The first man boarded the ship with his wife and decided to leave the second man on the island. He considered the other man unworthy to receive God's blessing, since none of his prayer has been answered. And the ship was about to leave. As the ship was about to leave, the first man heard a booming voice from heaven. A booming voice from heaven. It says, "Why are you leaving your companion on the island?" The man says, "My blessing are mine alone, since I was the one who prayed for them." The first man answered. His prayers were all an answer, and so he does not deserve anything. "You are mistaken," the voice rebuked him. He had only one prayer and one prayer alone. "Tell me," the first man asks. "Tell me, what's that one prayer that he prayed and that one prayer alone? Nothing else but that one prayer. Tell me," booming voice. "What is that one prayer that he prayed? Because as far as I see, you was never blessed."
And the voice says, first of all, the first man still said, what did he pray for that I should owe him anything? Because remember, the voice says, why are you leaving your companion? He said, well, his prayers have not been answered. Why should I take it with me? He's not blessed. He's unworthy. But then the voice says, but then, you know, he said, why are you leaving your companion? He said, tell me. Then the first man tell the voice, the booming voice, we should know it's God. Tell me, the first man asked the voice, what did he pray for that I should owe him anything? The booming voice says, we know it's God in the sense in the story. He prayed that all your prayers be answered. Amen. He prayed that all your prayers be answered. That's the response that God gave, or the booming voice gave to the first man. He prayed that all your voice, or all your prayer be answered. That's what he prayed for. Amen. So the question is, who was God listening to? Amen. What prayer was God listening to? The one that says, gimme, gimme, gimme? Or the one that says, Lord, bless them, bless him, bless her. Let's pray for this one. Let's pray for the one. God was listening, I believe, to the unselfish voice. Amen. The voice that says, I will do for you because I see you for who God wants you to be. I'm not here to judge you. I'm here to pray for you. So we wondering, who was God listening to in this case? You see, the first man thought God was listening to him, but we could rest assured that the prayer pretty much was a selfish prayer. But while the other person was praying for the second man was praying for the first man to be blessed. So therefore, who prayer is God is listening to? Because the prayer got to come from the heart, not from the head or from the eyes. We remember the prodigal, not the prodigal son, we remember the publican and the Pharisees. Well, the Pharisees prayed that how good he was and all that he had and all that he had done in the world and everything, how good he was in his life. Well, the publican says, forgive me, Lord, for I'm a sinner. Forgive me, Lord, for I have sinned. All the publican could say was, forgive me because I've done wrong. That was from the heart, not from the mind. We have a job to do, church. And we have a mission to conduct. There are folks who are hurting out there. And as a church, one thing we don't want to do is to walk a walk judging others. And I'm about to conclude soon. Main idea here, I want you to remember that as we walk this walk of faith, God is who provides all the time. Amen. We can't get in the perspective thinking that it's because of what I did, God is providing for me. Not because of what I have accomplished or how I walk my walk of faith. That's why God is doing for me. God do for me only because of his grace, not what I do. It's his grace. And for the same measure, God will do for those as well. Others who may not walk the walk I walk, but how can they come closer to God unless I pray and ask God to see and bless them as well? There is a mission, there is the great commission that God are calling us for, to bring souls into the church. I am good, yes, I like to believe, but my heart is yearning for those who are not saved. My heart is yearning to bring those into the doors of the church who do not walk with the Lord. Amen. I have the Lord with me, and I like to believe that God is with me. But I want God to be with everybody else as well. We have a job to do, saint. And it's important to understand that God provides for all of us. And in conclusion, I will wrap it up this way. We read in Exodus how God had delivered the people of Israel from the wilderness. How they went through and they went through and they complained and they asked God to provide for them because they trusted not on God but on man. Amen. They complained to Moses and they complained to Aaron about how they were brought into the wilderness, into the desert and died. Is that what God purposed for us to come out here and die? We are hungry. We need food. Sometimes we just think that man is the answer. The world is the answer. Man is the one who could answer the question, answer our need, answer what we want. So when they complained to Moses as a man. And Moses said, why are you complaining against me? I'm not the one who called you out here. I'm not the one who said, follow me into the wilderness. I'm just leading you as God lead me. So you got to set your eyes upon God, not on man. Amen. Don't set your eyes upon man. It's not me, but it's God. But when God said to Moses, I heard what happened. I heard them murmuring. I heard their complaint. And I will go ahead and feed them. I will go ahead and give them the food that they need. In the morning they shall have the manna, and in the evening they shall have meat. I will provide for them, and they will know that it's me, God, who provide. The same thing with the story I just read. All the while the first man thought it was him, his prayer. Because he is man, but he didn't realize it was God's grace, because there was another man praying for him. Amen. It is hard sometimes to think about it, how God operates, but it's all about what Jesus do. It is almost like a twist in a sense. That's why we must depend on the Spirit of God to walk with us and make every decision through prayer, even the smallest one. So God now deliver and set forth. But I want to tell you, saint, and I want to finish with this. I know I said that at least three times. We might leave you about 2 p.m. Amen. God hear you. He hear you. He hear you. Amen. He hear you. Amen. But when we pray, we want to pray like when we make a prayer request. We want to make the prayer request like Solomon did. God, give me wisdom. I want to be wise in my decision as I walk this walk of faith. Amen. I want to make God, give me something. When I ask God, what is it I'm looking for? What is it I don't have? What is it I'm missing here, Lord? What do I need to walk this walk of faith with you to draw closer and nearer to you? What is it happening within me that only you could see? That my brothers and sisters may see as well. And sometimes God may show you something that I need. And that's why we must be praying, because we don't want to reply in the wrong spirit. We're in a prayerful spirit. God hear your prayer. God hear my prayer. Amen. And as God calls us, amen, we should walk the walk of faith according to his need. Amen. And I'm going to leave you with the last one. Exodus 16:15. When the children of Israel saw it, they said one to another, it is manna that they wish not it was. And Moses say unto them, this is the bread which the Lord have given you to eat. All things come from God. All things come from God. We don't want to take God praises from him. We praise God for all that we have and all we have received, because he is the one that bring it down to our soul, to our heart, to our spirit. And it's not me, it is all God. And I pray, amen, this morning, Freeport United Methodist Church, that we receive God, to let God know, to let him know that we are attentive of his work of sanctification in our life. He's building, he's restoring, he's shaping, and he's molding. That when we walk amongst, amen, our brothers and sisters, with the grace of God, we remember also that as God give us grace, we walk in the world, because we are in the world, we are not part of the world, that God has given them grace to. They must know the grace that we have, that they may be partakers of that grace itself. Because the world is lost, and we are the one, the church of God is who God called to make the difference and to bring forth the word. Amen. So Freeport United Methodist Church, God will provide for what we need and what we need to do. We must trust God as we walk this walk of faith and understand that there is a greater purpose. But it's not about us. It's not about me. It's about God providing for all our need. Amen? Amen. Give God a hand praise. Amen.